Hello, this is Brandy from Dorky Dino. In this video, I wanted to show you more about my process behind making a watercolor painting. For this painting, I've already loosely sketched out what I want to paint. I used a picture of my friend's Corgi as a reference, and I started very loose for my sketch to get the proportions right, and then I added more detail as I went. I mostly used lines just to separate out where different colors and shades started. I didn't add much of any actual shading because I know I'll be covering it with paint anyway. Before doing a watercolor painting, I almost always tape down the edges. This will keep it from buckling as much when you're adding water to the paper. I just use masking tape or painter's tape, but some artists prefer to wet their paper beforehand and use gum tape. You can tape it straight to your table or painting surface, but then you do run into the risk of not being able to move it until the painting is done, so I tape mine to pieces of masonite board. In the past, I've even used cardboard. It's inexpensive and lightweight. The less water you plan on using, the less of a problem you'll have with buckling, so on small paintings, sometimes I don't bother taping at all. Right here, you can see me dabbing the paint with a paper towel. Since I didn't wait for the paint around the edges to dry, it started to spread. A paper towel can help dab up extra water and pigment and stop it from bleeding too far. If you're quick, you can even use a paper towel and water to lift the paint completely. This can be a great technique for fixing mistakes or even adding highlights. I think it's important to point out that all artists make mistakes, even professional artists who've been doing it for a long time. There are ways to fix your mistakes, cover them up, or even turn them into something else. One of the most fun parts of creativity is trying to think of alternative ways to fix a problem. So don't worry too much about mistakes. Even if you have to start over, now you know for sure you've learned something, and the next painting will be even better. So embrace your mistakes. You've probably noticed I'm not using the natural colors you would see on a Corgi. I love using bright, arbitrary colors. So for this painting, I've decided to use green and orange, which are my friend's two favorite colors. When I do a painting, I almost always start out loose, and then I get more detailed as I go. You'll notice that when I'm doing the loose work, I hold my brush more towards the middle or the back, and when I get more detailed, I inch closer to the tip of the brush. That's very intentional. Holding a brush or a pencil farther back gives you more expressive strokes. You can't see it in the video, but just above my painting, I have my photo reference that I'm looking at as I paint. I almost always use references for anything I create. It's a common misconception that artists don't use references. And a lot of people tell me they don't feel like a true artist because they can only draw if they have a reference. I just want to point out that almost all true artists do use references. In fact, the master artists you hear about in school, like Leonardo da Vinci, used references, whether it was live models or still lifes. Many of the great painters even traced just to start their work. Using references is an important way to learn and to make sure your art is accurate. One of the best ways to paint realistically is to focus on what you see rather than what you know. So instead of looking at it as a dog, just look at it as light and dark shapes. It can help if you kind of squint or unfocus your eyes and just identify what areas are the darkest and the lightest. You could also try flipping your reference and your painting upside down so you aren't as focused on what it actually is and just see the shapes. It seems counterintuitive, but this actually helps a ton, because it will stop you from making assumptions about what a dog is supposed to look like and allow you to draw what you actually see. When working with watercolor, it's important to think about any areas that are going to be really light or stay pure white. You can't really paint white on top of it unless you use a gouache or a different kind of paint. As I mentioned before, you can sometimes wet it and dab it with a paper towel, but it's difficult to get it back to pure white. So think ahead about what areas will be the lightest. In order to get a strong pigment without pulling up or damaging the paper, it helps to work in layers and let each layer dry before adding more watercolor to that area. I like to work on different sections of the painting while letting one area dry, but you can also use a hairdryer to make it faster. Just make sure it's not strong enough to push the pigment around, unless that's the look you're going for. Be sure to avoid scrubbing with your brush or pressing too hard, as this can cause the paper to start breaking down or pilling. If you're having trouble with the paper buckling, pilling, or pulling up, you may need to invest in a different watercolor paper. You'll want to avoid papers made of wood pulp and instead make sure it's 100% cotton. I like to use at least 140-pound paper. The higher the pounds, the thicker the paper, and the less likely it is to buckle.
My camera stopped recording, so that's why there's a little gap there, but I added some splatters and drips to the background. This is where it's really handy to be able to pick it up and move it as needed. At this point, I stepped back from the painting so I could look at it from a distance. This really helps to see any areas that need to be changed, or where contrast might need to be added. And here's the finished painting! If you have any questions about painting or anything I've done in the video, please feel free to leave a comment or reach out to me. I'll be happy to answer. I'll also be making more videos in the future, so if you liked this video, don't forget to subscribe so you can see when I make more. Have a great day and celebrate your dorkiness!